are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. For you are my rock and my fortress, and for your name's sake, you lead me and guide me. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God.
God's name is certainly holy in itself, but we pray his name.
the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray the psalm of the day. The Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song. His praise in the assembly of God. Let Israel be glad in his Maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their King. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation. Let the godly exalt in glory. Let them sing for joy on their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their throats, and two-edged swords in their hands, to execute vengeance on nations and punishments on peoples, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute on them the judgment written. This is honor for all his godly ones. Praise the Lord.
Visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only God's
definition of a saint. If we follow that definition, then a true saint is one who is fully conformed to the way of life portrayed in the Beatitudes. But when you read the Beatitudes, it is impossible to see how any of us could be a saint based on the standards they set forth. They pronounce blessings upon only the poor in spirit, the meek, those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, those who mourn, the merciful, the pure of heart, the peacemakers, and those persecuted for Christ's sake. How many of you would consider yourselves saints according to the criteria set by the Beatitudes? Have you always been poor in spirit, humbling yourself in the presence of God and in the presence of others? Or do you often have an arrogant and judgmental attitude? Are you perfectly meek? Or are you ever prideful or haughty? Do you always hunger and thirst after righteousness? Or do you have an insatiable appetite for your pet sins? Do you mourn over your great sins? Or do you excuse them? Or even celebrate them? Are you merciful as your Father in heaven is merciful, pardoning the debts of the undeserving? Or are you ever vindictive and grudge-bearing? Is your heart pure, or is it full of lusts, greed, and anger? Do you always promote peace, or have you instigated conflict? And finally, have you patiently suffered persecution for your Christian faith? Or have you run away from opportunities to suffer for Christ's name? Lord, have mercy upon us. That's the only thing we can cry after examining our lives in view of the Beatitudes. A little later in Matthew 5, Jesus says, "You therefore must be perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect." Does it get any more demanding than that? We cannot simply try hard enough to fulfill the standards of the Beatitudes and be perfect. That's clearly not good enough. The bar has been raised. We can't reach it. So, if there are no people who can live up to the expectations of the Beatitudes, then on what basis could they be called the definition of a saint? Does this mean there really are no saints and everyone who doesn't live by them is condemned to hell? Remember who gave us the Beatitudes. A saint is a holy one, and Jesus is the Holy One of God. He is the definition of a saint, and he is the one speaking to us this morning in the Beatitudes. He is the ideal man, God's chosen one, and he's the reason the Beatitudes are blessings to us sinners rather than curses. God has had mercy on us by sending his son Jesus to fulfill the Beatitudes. He lived them out during his earthly life and in his sacrificial death on the cross. By his resurrection, he won an eternal life in God's kingdom of heaven for us. And by our baptism in Christ, God credits the righteousness of Jesus to us and makes us beloved children of the Heavenly Father. We lost and condemned sinners are given the gift of sainthood completely as a gift. This is the great exchange in which Jesus takes what is ours, sin, death, and the wrath of God, and gives us what is his, forgiveness, eternal life, and the grace of God. Now we'll go through and see how Jesus specifically fulfilled each of the Beatitudes. Then we'll also see that since Jesus has done it all for us, we are set free from sin and the law to live out the Beatitudes in our lives as those who are blessed by the gift of or spirit do not make any claims on God, but stand before him as beggars. According to Jesus' divine nature, he never was a beggar before God. But St. Paul tells us in Philippians 2 that even though Jesus was equal with God, he emptied himself and humbled himself all the way down to the point of death on the cross. And why did he die? For our sins. St. Paul also wrote, "You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich." Jesus himself said, "Whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be your slave. Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus, out of sheer grace toward us, humbled himself even to the point of becoming a slave to his disciples. He gave himself as a ransom for our sins in order to provide us with countless blessings. He gave up his spirit on the cross to richly deliver forgiveness and God's kingdom to us. The second beatitude, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." Jesus mourned for us sinners. Isaiah 53 says of Jesus, "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed." Jesus mourned in the Garden of Gethsemane and on the cross, suffering for our sins. But on the third day, he was comforted. He was raised from the dead, and now he lives to give comfort to all who mourn over their sins by forgiving their sins and clothing them with his righteousness. The third beatitude, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Meek and poor in spirit are basically synonymous terms for not making claims on God. In Genesis 12, the Lord promised Abram a land for possession, which was never retained by Israel. Jesus merited the true promised land for his people through his impoverishment on the cross. St. Paul speaks of how we Christians inherit the earth when he writes, "If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come." When a lost and condemned sinner is brought into Christ, he is made a new creation, an heir of the new heavens and the new earth that Christ has prepared through his saving work. And Jesus says that on the last day, the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." The fourth beatitude, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." Jesus' great love for us manifested itself in a hunger and thirst to acquire righteousness for us. When he was baptized, he identified himself with sinners in order to fulfill all righteousness. Righteousness is what God has done for us in Christ. He has justified us, that is, declared us righteous. St. Paul writes that Jesus was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. When God raised his Son from the dead, he justified him. He declared him righteous to all the world. Since Jesus had taken upon himself the sin of the world, he had to die to pay the debt owed to God for the guilt of those sins. Jesus died an innocent death because he bore. He died an unrighteous death because he bore our sin. God declared Jesus righteous when he raised him from the dead, and in doing so, also declared us righteous. And his righteousness now belongs to us by faith. Now our hunger and thirst for a righteousness that saves us from our sins has been satisfied in him. The fifth beatitude, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy." Jesus bore the sins of the world on the cross, and when he cried out, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" he was asking for he has now poured out upon us in holy baptism. St. Paul writes in Titus 3, when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. The sixth beatitude, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Pure in heart means completely committed to God with complete integrity. Jesus is the only one who loved the Lord with all his heart and mind and soul and strength. He also is the only one who can see God face to face, as John 1:18 says. And then St. John writes in his epistles, the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The blood of Jesus purifies our sinful hearts and makes us righteous. And he then lets us see the heart of God in his word and sacraments. St. Paul wrote, God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And as Jesus said to Philip one time, whoever has seen me has seen the Father. By faith in Jesus, we see God's love for us, and in heaven we will see him face to face. The seventh beatitude, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Jesus identified himself as a peacemaker in the messianic prophecy of Isaiah 9, when he is called the Prince of Peace. In his baptism, Jesus was called Son of God. St. Paul wrote, Romans 5, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And in Colossians 1, in Christ all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Paul says that we have peace with God when we are justified by faith, and that we've been reconciled to God through the blood of Jesus' cross. So in baptism, just like Jesus, we are called sons of God, heirs of the kingdom, permanent residents in the Father's household. And the eighth beatitude, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. No one can exemplify suffering for righteousness' sake like Jesus. His suffering is what merited the kingdom of heaven for us. When Jesus was on trial, Pilate's wife called Jesus a righteous man, that is, blameless and undeserving of persecution. We know that Barabbas instead should have been destroyed, for he truly was unrighteous. We too should have died for our unrighteousness, but Jesus suffered for our sins instead, bringing us to God and making us righteous. As he suffered, he remained like a lamb to the slaughter, not speaking out against his foes, but meekly bearing our punishment. So we see how Jesus has perfectly fulfilled the first eight beatitudes for us. And now he invites all of us who are baptized into him to take up our crosses and follow him in the saintly life of imitating him. He invites us to look at the Beatitudes as the Christ life, the Christ-like life to which we have been called. If we are followers of Christ, we also will suffer them before we enter glory, just as he did. In the ninth Beatitude, Jesus gives us a crucial insight into what it means to be blessed as a disciple of his. He says, blessed are you, or literally blessed are y'all, when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. We normally describe blessings as things that we recognize as good gifts from God. A happy family, a good church, wisdom, strength, good health, material possessions. On the other hand, persecution is viewed negatively, since it brings about pain, suffering, doubts, inconvenience, disappointment, fear. Jesus completely rearranges the way we're to look at the world. The follower of Jesus is called blessed when he is persecuted for Jesus' sake. Though persecution is not an obvious reason for joy, that is precisely where rejoicing is said to come from. As is so often the case in Holy Scripture, God flips around how the world looks at things. The false glory expectation for the church is one of unbridled success, but the true cross expectation of the church is to suffer persecution just as Christ has. The apostles in Acts 5 were beaten by the authorities for preaching in the name of Jesus. St. Luke tells us they rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name of Jesus. Instead of taking persecution as a sign to give up, they preached even more vigorously about Jesus. We should note in this example that the apostles were being persecuted since they were public ministers of the gospel. This is possibly where the persecution of the church would be most visible in our country even today, as an unbelieving public disparages the public ministry of the church. However, this persecution will be found in the life of each believer in some manner. Jesus says, when they revile or persecute you, not if. Persecution for the faith is a sign of discipleship. But be clear, the absence of persecution at a specific time in a Christian's life doesn't mean that we've stopped being disciples. But when persecution for the sake of Jesus comes, we can rejoice in it. Since he is blessing us with the opportunity to confess his name and participate in his sufferings. Of course, St. Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. So we should also rejoice in the times of peace and prosperity that the Lord gives us. The key to it all is faith. If we believe that the Lord Jesus is ours in good times and in bad, and if we're willing to confess his name, even at the risk of persecution, then we can remain confident and content no matter the situation. The Beatitudes apply first to Jesus. He is the definition of a saint. But then the Beatitudes apply to the church, to all believers who are called saints by faith in Jesus. We can never drive a wedge between the life of Jesus and the life of the church, because the church will always be conformed to the life, death, and resurrection of her head. This must happen because it is God's will, but on this All Saints Day, we must also remember that our conforming to Christ in this life is only partial. Strictly speaking, Jesus is the only living human saint, because the rest of us are both sinner and saint at the same time. Not one of us is only saint and not also sinner. Believers in Christ are actually 100% of each. 100% sinner, 100% saint, all at one time. When you were baptized, your sins were forgiven through Jesus' blood, and you received the Holy Spirit and the righteousness of Christ. God doesn't do his work in fractions. He doesn't make us a bit holy or progressively more holy throughout our lives. No, the Holy Spirit grants Christ's holiness to each of you, making you 100% saint. At the same time, we retain our sinful flesh, and so we're 100% sinner. But because of the righteousness and holiness of Jesus, the Father does not count your trespasses against you, and instead counts the righteousness and holiness of Saint Jesus for you. That defines you as blessed by God, Beatus, as a saint. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Victoria was the sister-in-law of Rita Ritzner, and her services will be this Wednesday. We pray for also for Lisa Smith's parents. Her father, Dwayne, is hospitalized with COVID-19, but he is doing better, and hopefully will be able to come home this week. And Lila is recovering at home and looking forward to being reunited with her husband. We also pray today for missionaries, for those who serve in the military, for law enforcement, for our shut-ins, and we rejoice this week at the birthdays of Dustin Betcher, Michael Hart, Eli Martinez, and Jamie Robledo. Let us turn to the Lord in prayer. O blessed Heavenly Father, God of all comfort and Lord of our salvation, on this All Saints Day, we honor the memory of Christian loved ones who have preceded us and are now with you in heaven. It is sweet comfort to know that while they were here, they too were filled with the joy of believing in Jesus, and that they have received the goal of their faith, the salvation of their souls. We thank you, blessed Lord, that in your grace you called them out of darkness into the marvelous light of your truth, so that they came to trust the love and forgiveness you've given the world for your Son. Whenever sorrow floods our hearts because of the losses we have individually suffered, may this be our comfort, that our loved ones, having remained faithful unto death, are resting safely and joyfully in your presence. We know that the glory which is now theirs is not worthy to be compared to the sufferings of this present time. May this occasion remind us that the hour of our own departure from this veil of tears is drawing ever nearer, so that with the Holy Spirit's help, we continue to trust in the promise of everlasting life through Christ alone. As long as we live here in the valley of the shadow of death, looking to the glorious appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, help us to give a good witness before the world concerning the hope that is in us. Shelter us, dear Heavenly Father, in all our troubles. Give us strength to bear them, and provide us in due time with relief. Raise up those who are fallen. Lift the burdens from the oppressed. Provide for all according to our various needs. Help us bear with patience the afflictions of the future while learning to deal with the sorrows of the past. Through the sufferings of this present life, may we learn to trust you more and to treasure our treasures in heaven through Christ. Graciously keep us steadfast in true faith until that hour when, one by one, we are called before your throne to receive from your Son the crown of righteousness reserved for the faithful, and to join our voices with the saints who have been gathered there before us in singing their praises. The Lord, we also intercede on behalf of those in need of your mercy. Be with Bessie and Alan as they walk through the valley of the shadow of death, help them to fear no evil. Be with Dwayne and Lila as they recover from illness, and grant them restoration of health. Be with the family of Victoria, that they might grieve not hopelessly, but rather with confidence in the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Bless all Christians suffering persecution for the sake of Christ's holy name. Bless us with sufficient rain and seasonable weather. Be with the unemployed and underemployed, and give them their daily bread. Watch over all pregnant and nursing mothers and the children entrusted to their care, give them increasing happiness and their blessings. Send your Holy Spirit to accompany all missionaries, especially Charles, Eric, David, and Charles. Send your holy angels to watch over those who serve in the military, especially Sean, Blaine, Joshua, Joseph, James, Gaston, Nicholas, Scott, and Aaron. Sustain our shut-ins with your holy word and sacraments. Joe, Lynn, Carolyn, Dwayne, Willard, Anne, Joyce, Lynn, Virginia, Cheryl, Doris, Alice, Ellen, Ray, Ruth, and Jack. We also thank you for granting another year of life and grace to Dustin, Michael, Eli, and Jamie. Continue to crown them with your blessings. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, whose voice shall call the dead to life, whose grace shall grant the victory to all who believe. Amen.
Thank you.
because thou didst mightily govern and protect thy holy church, which the blessed apostles and evangelists instructed in thy divine and saving truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, therefore with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
Thank you.
comfort and peace in this sacrament. And we beseech thee not to forsake thy children, but evermore to rule our hearts and minds by thy Holy Spirit, that we may be able constantly to serve thee through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost,